Hi, I'm Peter K. Steinberg. As you know, this is a talk called I Should Be Loving This, Sylvia Plath's The Perfect Place and the Bell Jar. I gave it first at the 2007 Oxford Symposium for Plath's 75th birthday, and then Smith College in April of 2008 had a mini symposium where a bunch of us regathered and had a presentation there. So I revised it for that, and this is the text from Smith College. In late 2001, a friend contacted me about a published short story Sylvia Plath refers to in a letter to her mother on the 9th of November, 1961. Plath says, I'll send for a copy of my awful First Ladies magazine story. It came out on my birthday week. I got a very sweet fan letter for it, in which the woman, also a writer, took me for an expert on Canada and Whitby, the sailing port I visited for a day. As a description of this does not match any of those in the collection Johnny Panic and the Bible of Dreams, I planned a research trip to Smith College. At Smith in January 2002, I read the stories not collected in Johnny Panic. In Plath's The Lucky Stone, Joanna, a Canadian who recently lost both her parents in a car accident, is on a weekend trip at the coast with her English fiancé, Kenneth. During the trip, their relationship fractures irreparably. Plath names only one place in the story, Staithes. Consulting a map of England, I found Staithes to be just north of Whitby. At the top of the typescript of the story, in Plath's hand, is the following annotation, sold for £15, 15 shillings, by Jennifer Hassel. Smith holds a letter to Plath from Helena F. Anon, an editor at My Weekly, a women's weekly magazine based in the United Kingdom. The letter rejects two stories, but encourages her to submit others. It was written on the 19th of January, 1962, and reads, I regret having to return these as not quite suitable for My Weekly, particularly so as both stories have a sense of quality and sincerity that I like very much, and liked in your The Lucky Stone, which we published last year. As the magazine is located in Scotland, I wrote a friend in the UK to see if she could contact them and inquire about back issues. After 6 months, we received a photocopy of the published story, which appeared in the 28th of October 1961 issue of My Weekly. Either the editors or Plath made an interesting revision at some point, changing the title from The Lucky Stone to The Perfect Place. The setting for the story grew out of a visit Plath and Ted Hughes made to Whitby in August 1960. Based on references found in letters home, I believe she drafted the story in November of that year. Throughout the fall of 1960, Plath's letters home chronicle her endeavors at short story writing for the women's magazine market. By the 28th of November, Plath completed one story, was at work on a second, and had a plot for a third. She also mentions being in contact with a literary agent. Jennifer Hassel, who sold The Lucky Stone, worked for the literary agency A.M. Heath & Co., then located on Dover Street in London. Hassel contacted Plath after reading a story in the London magazine, most likely The Daughters of Blossom Street, in the May 1960 issue. Plath met with Hassel several times, and in a letter home written on the 24th of December 1960, mentions that her fine, lively agent was actively marketing her manuscripts. However, it is unclear exactly when the story sold. I want to draw out some comparisons between The Perfect Place and The Bell Jar. The Perfect Place is one of the last stories, if not the last story, Plath completed prior to writing The Bell Jar. The similarities between the two works are so strong, and the story, its characters, episodes, and themes appears to me as a blueprint for the novel. In the opening scenes of both The Perfect Place and The Bell Jar, the main characters lodge in unfamiliar surroundings. In The Perfect Place, Joanna lays in bed at a boarding house. She feels suspended in time and place, and at a decisive point in her life. In The Bell Jar, Esther feels trapped in the Amazon Hotel. The windows are fixed so that she is unable to open them and lean out. Confined in this manner, she feels herself melting into the shadows like a negative of a person that she had never before seen. Plath develops Esther's feelings and expectations through Joanna in The Perfect Place. Joanna wants a small marriage ceremony, but Kenneth's family insists on a full traditional wedding. Kenneth's mother attributes Joanna's indifference to her extended period of mourning and coerces her into relinquishing any role in the planning of her nuptials. In addition to planning the wedding, Joanna and Kenneth must furnish their flat. Joanna admits, "The prospect of choosing carpets, curtains, and furniture to please Kenneth's exacting taste settled on her heart like a weight." On a walk through Whitby, they discuss a problem wall in their London flat. Here, Plath has some fun with the description of the wallpaper. She describes it as white and silver on a dark green ground, which calls to mind the cover of a book of poems recently published at the time, namely The Colossus. In the selection process, the wallpaper selection process, Joanna feels she must suppress her opinions, and her nonchalance and naivete pleases Kenneth. She asks, "What do you have in mind, dear? I'm relying on you to guide me, you know," with sarcasm that Plath perfects in The Bell Jar. It is evident that the spectacle of the wedding and life planning does not interest Joanna at all. She forebodingly remembers the long, stuffy afternoon spent turning the pages of expensive wallpaper from one cold, pompous pattern to another. She chides herself, saying, "I should be loving this, yet I feel stifled, hemmed in." Regarding her opportunity as guest editor for Ladies' Day magazine, Esther Greenwood says, "I was supposed to be having the time of my life. I was supposed to be the envy of thousands of other college girls just like me all over America who wanted nothing more than to be tripping about, drinking martinis on some starlight roof in the company of several anonymous young men with all-American bone structures." Esther admits, "I guess I should have been excited the way most of the other girls were, but I couldn't get myself to react. I felt very still and empty." Joanna should be loving this time of her life as she prepares for marriage. Likewise, Esther, the envy of thousands of other college girls, was supposed to be having the time of her life as a guest editor. Both characters are incapable of appreciating these opportunities and experiences. A bell jar surrounds Joanna just as it does Esther. The root cause of Joanna's apathy is Kenneth, and by extension, society in general. The tension evident in their relationship mirrors the discord between Esther Greenwood and Buddy Willard. Kenneth's occupation as a junior partner in a law firm parallels the promise of Buddy's medical school training. Buddy, we learn, becomes a member of the AMA and earns pots of money. Joanna tries to convince herself that Kenneth's career comes first. When it becomes clear to her that the relationship is failing, her instinct is to blame herself. She asks, "Why must I feel so rebellious? What is happening to me?" She suddenly realizes that the fault lies not with her, but with Kenneth, and that she does not have to take the back burner to his wishes and whims. She looks to him, sees only a tall, unbending shape, and realizes Kenneth would never understand or make an effort to understand the painful changes taking place in her heart. These questions of Joanna's, why must I feel so rebellious, and what's happening to me, resemble Esther's situation in the bell jar. Almost in reply to Joanna's questions, Esther asserts, the trouble was, I hated the idea of serving men in any way. Later, to her psychiatrist, she builds on the previous statement, saying, what I hate is the thought of being under a man's thumb. A man doesn't have a care in the world, while I've got a baby hanging over my head like a big stick to keep me in line. Both Joanna and Esther, however, eventually reject the prospect of the affluent and secure lifestyle afforded to the spouse of either a successful doctor or a lawyer. They also directly defy contemporary societal expectations for young women. Kenneth treats Joanna frequently as though she were a child. The visit to Whitby is in itself a reward for the compliance of giving in to his mother regarding the wedding planning. In a scene at the seaside rock pools, Kenneth slips and falls, muddying up his suit. He takes his embarrassment out on Joanna, verbally scolding her. I think we've had enough for one morning, Joanna. She reacts slowly, like a child caught playing out too late by an impatient parent, and resigns herself to being led sternly back to the boarding house. Later that evening, Joanna spends time in Simon's garret. Simon's an artist in the story, in Simon's garret looking at his artwork. Kenneth calls for her from the stair landing. Joanna reluctantly says, I better go now. The image of a child caught playing out too late by an impatient parent reminds me of a scene in chapter 12 of The Bell Jar, which is also set on a coastline. Esther visits her hometown of Winthrop in the violet light. Well, it's not Winthrop in the story, but it is Winthrop. In the violet light of the afternoon. She sits on a log trapped by a sandbar below the town water tower, which is itself a symbol of a bell jar. Esther plans to drown herself, but a small boy called Arthur is nearby lobbing round purple stones into the ocean. Arthur's mother ventures onto the sandbar, calling for him to return closer to the beach. And like Kenneth and Whitby, she slips on the rutted beach terrain. Arthur then leaves, as the pull of his mother is too strong. Esther, however, looks toward the sea, toward its deathly depths, and resists the call from the absent father, the absent parent. Plath always associates the sea, especially the waters off the Massachusetts coast, where she places Esther, with her dead father. The dead father is the impatient parent. Unlike Joanna and Arthur, who acquiesce when called back, Esther rejects her father's summons. She does retreat, however, to her mother and their house in the suburbs. At the rock pools in The Perfect Place, Plath describes the sea as the white froth of foam. This imagery appears in The Bell Jar as Esther contemplates drowning when a wave, lipped with white froth, collapses over her feet. Both these images derivate from Plath's 1958 poem, Full Fathom Five. Old man, you surface seldom. Then you come in with the tides coming, when seas wash cold, foam-capped, white hair, white beard, far-flung, a dragnet, rising, falling as waves crest and trough. In Kenneth and Buddy, Plath creates, to say the least, unlikable men. In Simon, in the story, and Constantine, in the novel, she creates sympathetic alternatives. Simon, the artist, correlates to Constantine, the simultaneous interpreter. Joanna and Simon connect immediately. Joanna thinks, he's nice. He's real. He isn't thinking of the impression he's making. In The Bell Jar, Esther comments favorably on Constantine's intuition. This Constantine won't mind if I'm too tall and don't know enough languages and haven't been to Europe. He'll see through all that to what I really am. In the story and in the novel, Plath sets her characters in automobile rides that allow her female protagonists to feel freedom. On the way to Staithes, Simon notices a difference in Joanna's disposition and remarks, "You're smiling." This leads Joanna to confide all sorts of details about her home life in Canada and even the difficult story of her parents' death. She calls this outburst a weakness, which she never allowed herself in Kenneth's presence. Being apart from Kenneth allows Joanna to feel liberated, as though Kenneth, that tall, unbending shape, was her own personal bell jar. In the same way, Constantine's intuition enables Esther to let down her guard as she quickly senses that he is not a protege of Mrs. Willard. The car ride around Manhattan frees her, and she feels happier than she had been since she was about 9 and running along the white-hot beaches with her father. There are other likenesses present between the two texts. Mrs. Welbeck serves tea to Joanna in a blue-rimmed cup. At Belsize, the nurse delivers Esther's breakfast in blue china. The Abbey at Whitby sits perched atop its headland like a great gray seabird. In Winthrop, Esther sits on a log under the stout gray cylinder of the water tower on its commanding hill. Just as The Perfect Place and The Bell Jar begin with similar scenes, both end with the heroine crossing a threshold by stepping through a doorway. In a critical sense, in the story, in a critical scene in the story, Joanna breaks her engagement to Kenneth. She then opens the door and steps out. This act frees her from a kind of imprisonment, from the promise of a life not suited to her needs. Likewise, after being patched, retreaded, and approved for the road, Esther too walks through an open door and into her own freedom in the final scene of The Bell Jar. To conclude, Plath's short stories, like her poetry, got progressively better as she aged. This is especially true of her Boston stories, The $15 Eagle, The Daughters of Blossom Street, and Johnny Panic and the Bible of Dreams, written in 1958 and 1959. These stories mark a turning point. Her style became looser, the language more colloquial, and her characters and dialogues are more colorful and more natural. As a result, Plath's stories attracted the attention of publishers more sophisticated than 17, Mademoiselle, or even her holy grail, The Ladies' Home Journal. This being the case, she longed still to break into the women's magazine market, which letter after letter in late 1960 relates. The creation of Joanna and eventually of Esther closely follows Plath's own maturity and identity as a writer and as a woman. The late Al Alvarez remarks on this transformation in Plath's demeanor in his book, The Savage God. When he first met Plath in early 1960, he says she seemed effaced. He describes her as bright, clean, competent, friendly, and yet rather distant, subdued. Later that year, she came across as easier, wittier, less constrained than before. By June 1962, Alvarez describes her as changed. She was no longer quiet and withheld. She seemed solid and complete. Like Plath, both Joanna and Esther are effaced, as well as bright, clean, competent. Like Plath, both Joanna and Esther struggle to understand the painful changes taking place in their hearts. Through the construction of these two characters, Plath, in the absence of critical primary source material from this period, i.e. her journals, accurately documents changes that took place in her life. As we know with Plath, the biography is never too far beneath the surface of her creative writing. Plath's own experiences throughout the 1950s made writing The Bell Jar possible. She began to write about the experience of her breakdown in fictional form as early as 1954 and 1955, in the stories In the Mountains and Tongues of Stone. Though she clearly had scenes and episodes in her mind, she lacked a credible and believable lead character. It was not until Plath created Joanna in The Perfect Place that she built a female character capable of becoming her true heroine and spokeswoman, Esther Greenwood. Thank you very much. If you have any questions or comments or concerns, please leave them here on YouTube or tweet at me. Thanks. Bye-bye.